Coming up on Dr. Kiki's Science Hour, we're talking about science in the UK with Dr. Jennifer Roan. That's up next on Dr. Kiki's Science Hour.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Dr. Kiki's Science Hour is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Dr. Kiki's Science Hour with Dr. Kiki, recorded on Thursday, November 18th, 2010. Science is vital. Welcome, everyone, to Dr. Kiki's Science Hour. I'm Dr. Kiki, and this is the hour where we dig in. We get deep, dirty with the science for an hour. One topic, one expert, 1 hour. And I hope you're ready to dig into something a little interesting off of our normal beaten path of scientific topics. This is actually science in the public sector. It's the story of a British science uprising, and joining me today is Dr. Jennifer Roan, and she is as from her biography, she was born in Stowe, Ohio, received a BA in biology summa cum laude from Oberlin College in 1990, and a PhD in microbiology from the University of Washington, Seattle in 1996. She moved to London for four postdoctoral scientific training, and then to Amsterdam, the Netherlands, for a stint in a startup biotech. She's currently on staff as an academic cell biologist at the MRC Laboratory for Molecular Cell Biology at University College London. She's also the author of two lab-lit novels, Experimental Heart and The Honest Look, the second of which has recently reached market in the UK. She launched the website LabLit to help promote the use of science and scientist characters in mainstream fiction and to illuminate the world of scientists and laboratory culture. She blogs at Mind the Gap, which is a nature.com blog. Jennifer, thank you for joining me and welcome to the show.
Thank you, Kiki.
You're welcome. So to get started, I just wanted to, go back in time to September when this whole hubbub, what I'm calling the British Science Uprising of 2010, when it kind of got started. As we know at this point in time, England has been cutting its budget. There's all over the world we have budgetary problems as a result of the recession and also monetary mismanagement, and England is not immune to that any more than the United States is. But England seems to be cutting things, and it looked like science was coming under the knife. Can you tell us a little bit about what happened?
Sure. Well, it looked as if science is being cut. It looked as if science was about to be cut, and how it started was a speech by a cabinet minister. And he basically said, listen, you scientists, you know that you can do a little bit more with less, and we're having a spending review that's coming up in a few weeks' time, and you need to prepare yourselves for massive cuts. Now, the British government has responded to the recession by deciding to balance the budget in basically a year by just cutting everything. So we knew something terrible was happening, but in this speech, Vince Cable, the minister, was saying something like 40%. The science budget might pick up by 40%. That's a huge number, especially if you consider that in this country, it's incredibly competitive. I mean, it's competitive everywhere in science. It's a difficult job. It's hard to get grants. It's hard to get funding. But imagine if, you know, they're only funding 10 to 15% of all grants, and suddenly 40% were cut. It was going to be just insane. So I got incredibly angry. That's how it started.
So you got,
I felt like the Incredible Hulk.
So you got incredibly angry and you took it out on your blog.
That's right. I decided no more Dr. Nice Guy. You know, scientists, they sit in their labs, they do their research, they keep their head down, they keep their nose clean, they work really hard. But they don't tend to sort of notice what's going on outside, especially in politics. Now, I'm as unpolitical as the next person. I had never done anything like this in my life. I'd never even thought about it. And people are always saying, oh, you scientists, come on, why don't you lobby, the government, why don't you get involved in this and that? And I usually say, no, thank you. I'm a little busy in the lab. But this time, something just snapped. And I said, no more Dr. Nice Guy. And I wrote this blog post. I dashed it off in about 15 minutes, basically saying, scientists should take to the streets. That was basically my big idea. And I didn't really think it was going to happen, to be perfectly honest. You know, I was angry. I said we should take to the streets. I basically started a hashtag, science is vital. I put it out on Twitter, and I thought, right, that's my activism for today. But amazingly, something happened. Everybody started tweeting about it and contacting me with offers of support. I basically struck a nerve. And what I think it was is a lot of British people were saying, oh, we really should do something about this speech, you know. Oh, what can we do? You know, it's a very sort of British way of responding to a crisis. And what they really needed was an American to come in there and just kick some butt. So that's what I did.
An American coming from a history of standing up and marching or protesting when something is not considered right, and standing up for yourself.
It's true. Yeah, I went to Oberlin College where there were a lot of protests were carried out. I mean, I feel a bit silly about some of it now, but you know, it has a strong tradition of demonstration, and I definitely imbibed a lot of that when I was an undergraduate.
So what ended up happening? You had people who got behind you, they read your blog post, they started using the hashtag. I remember on Twitter, I started seeing also several individuals I was following just suddenly have this science is vital in almost every tweet that they posted. Yeah. How fast did it grow? What seemed to be the catalyst, and what happened?
Well, I think it was urgency, because we only had about 4 weeks, well, three and a half weeks until the spending review was meant to be announced. And obviously, if you're going to announce a big, massive cut, you're not just going to decide the day before. So I decided, you know, we've only got 2 weeks really to make a difference. What can we do in 2 weeks? So there was a lot of urgency there, and I wanted to have a march. I wanted to have a big march in central London. I wanted to have a petition. I wanted to do all these things, but we only had 2 or 3 weeks to make a difference. So I think the urgency was really driving people. I think people saw, if we don't do something, if scientists don't actually stand up for our rights, then nobody's going to do it for us. So who's going to stand up and defend science if scientists can't even get out of their labs? So that was, I think, the urgency that drove it. That there was a very, very short time limit, and there was a lot of passion.
And what happened? You said you didn't really expect people to get up and march, but I found, after following some links and different things, I found this Facebook page, Stand Up for Science. It sounded like you actually had rallies. You had people coming together to actually stand up and march for science.
Well, we did organize a rally for the 20th of... Sorry, for the 9th of October. And that was very short notice. In Britain, it's quite difficult to get permission to assemble near the center of government because of all the terrorism legislation. Right. So we coordinated with the Metropolitan Police. They had us in, they're very nice. They did the good cop routine on us. They had two policemen. They were very, very nice. They really wanted to help us. In Britain, there's a strong tradition of public polite disobedience. So they're one of the things that the police do in Britain is that they're charged with helping the public to demonstrate peacefully. So they helped us do that. We did organize that date, 9th of October, and then we just tweeted it and emailed it and just spread the word as far and wide as we could. That in 3 weeks' time, even before we had permission to do it, we set the date. We said, listen, we're going to march. In the end, we couldn't get permission to march. It's a bit too complicated. It involves too much police time and cordons and things like that. But we did get permission to have a massive static demonstration. And we did do that. We had 2,000 plus scientists in white coats.
Wow.
It was really great because it was very positive. It wasn't a violent protest. Nobody handcuffed themselves to anything. Nobody got in trouble. But it was very humorous. We had people in white coats. We had people, you know, buckyballs on a stick. We had a lot of placards with, you know, the international symbol for chemical irritant is a yellow triangle, and they put the government's minister's face in the middle of it saying irritant. Just very, 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 very funny. You know, scientists are very clever people, and Most people don't realize it, but we have a pretty good sense of humor. And there were a lot, that showed a lot in the placards that we were waving and the chanting. We even did some really terrible singing. We had a lineup of speakers. We had science comedians. It was brilliant. So I think it was a very, very powerful demonstration. And the press were out in force. There were so many people from the BBC and from Reuters and news crews crawling around interviewing people. And the message really got out way more than I thought it would.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask, is what kind of coverage did you get, and what was the response from this this protest, this peaceful protest?
Well, we had about, I think we had more than 100 pieces of individual coverage. I mean, I was on the national radio that morning. A lot of my colleagues were on the national radio, sort of what, like your NPR, this BBC Radio 4. We were on BBC News, so that's the world website. We had newspaper articles. We had all sorts. We even had some coverage in Canada and a few in America. I think it was a bit of a curiosity, all these white coats demonstrating. But the best thing about it is we had one message. We thought that there was only one message that would work, and that would be the economic argument. Just basically, we weren't fighting for our jobs. We weren't complaining about, you know, cuts and things. We wanted to make the point, which is a valid point and a no-brainer, that science actually fuels the economy. So if you cut science, you're actually shooting yourself in the foot. It's like you have this golden goose, and it's, you know, the economy is floundering. We need to get out of this recession. The last thing you want to do is cut science, innovation, and tech, because that's what's driving the economy. So that was our simple message. We stayed on message. We didn't whine about our jobs. We didn't get angry. We just made this, you know, reasoned, scientific sort of point. Science is vital for the economy. And the press pretty much reproduced that message very helpfully. Nice. Verbatim. They almost didn't even question it, I think because it was such a no-brainer. So that probably explains what happened next, the good news that happened next.
Which was.
Yeah,
giving me a cliffhanger here.
A novelist. But, well, we had 35,000 signatures on this petition, which is pretty good for 3 weeks. I delivered it with my colleagues to number 10 Downing Street, which is where David Cameron was, although he didn't come out. Arnold Schwarzenegger was in there at the time, so they didn't let us in. But they opened the door. They opened the door, and you pass the petition through. It was this huge stack of paper. And then we got a call from David Willetts, who's the science minister. He's on the cabinet. He called us and said, come talk to us. So the whole science is vital contingent strolled down the road to the Department of Business, and we went up and we talked to this cabinet minister for 40 minutes. Nice. He gave us 40 minutes of his time. It was amazing. Just a bunch of scientists. And what happened was the spending review was announced on the 20th, and we were all just desperately afraid, because although we'd done all this, we had a lobby in Parliament as well, we'd done all this work, we had no idea what was going to happen. And then that morning, the news came down that there had been basically a freeze of the science budget, so they didn't cut it at all.
It's not going up, but not cut either. So that's, you know, that's at least nothing from the status quo would be removed.
Exactly. And with inflation, it actually does equate to a cut of sorts. Over 4 years, it'll be about 8 or 9%. Nowhere near
40%.
The sort of 40, 30, 20% that they had been threatening. So we felt pretty good about that. And actually, the cabinet minister then came out publicly and said that our campaign had been a key, sort of a key reason why the decision had been made. I don't know if that's just politics and him saying that, but we have been publicly acknowledged with making a difference. So I feel pretty happy about that.
Yeah,
seriously, happy.
You absolutely should. I mean, that's to go from getting upset and writing a blog post to having it actually impact a government policy decision, a financial decision that could have affected not just scientists around the country, but also the country's economy, which, as you said, was your main message. I mean, you should be pretty proud of yourself. Congratulations.
I am. And actually, I was a little worried because I thought, you know, I've been really, really naughty and not spending a lot of time in the lab. You know, this is basically a month out of my life that I spent on this. And it wasn't just me. It was about 12 of us. And we were working nonstop, you know, day and night, trying to get the word out. And I thought, oh, God, I'm going to get in trouble with my boss. You know, the people who give me the grant money, they're going to find out about this. And I thought, oh, God. But actually, it turned out my boss was really thrilled. that I'd done it. My head of department was bragging about it. You know, I've been getting emails from really, really famous scientists who would never normally have talked to me because I'm just a lowly postdoc.
Right.
So thanking me. And I think that although I was worried this might affect my career, I think it may have actually, well, at least it was neutral. It didn't hurt my career to have wasted, you know, a month out of the lab for this.
Right. Do you think that you might get be seen now as a political activist voice for scientists? Has that come across in any communications?
I think people are asking us what we're going to do next, and we've met in the pub a few times, and we do plan to carry on. I mean, we don't want to be proactive in that. I mean, there are so many fights you could pick. Now people are worried about physics. You know, biology got spared but actually biology got a little bit of extra money. Physics might be in trouble, but we can't really fight every battle. We're also worried about immigration. They're going to cap skilled migrant entry, and that will impact science as well. But we decided, you know, we can't fight too many battles. So what we're going to do is just stay on standby. And if anything, you know, if the ring fence is actually threatened or sort of undermined somehow, I mean, there's ways of sort of getting around a ring fence by, you know, going underneath and taking sort of money around the houses, sort of. And I think that if something like that happens, we'll rise up again. And we now have 35,000 people in our database. So I sort of look at it like the immune system. You know, the first time you get a cold, you build up some resistance. And we did that. We have this database of 35,000 people who signed the petition. But if something happens like next year, we've got those people already, and we can build from that and make a much, much bigger noise, especially if we have more notice. Next time I'd like more than 3 weeks notice.
That would be nice. Maybe, you know, just ask the politicians to to keep you in mind. No. You said something at the beginning of the hour that struck a nerve with me, is the statement that, oh, you scientists, you know how to make do with less. Do you, from talking with people and from the month that you've been working on this, the time that you put into it, and probably now the conversations that have been started in your life as a result of this, do you find that outside of science, people think that way about scientists? I mean, is it just, you know, we're scrappy and we can, you know, make do with gum and duct tape or shoelace and do science? Or
I think that actually a lot of people don't realize, you know, the message wasn't getting through completely. You know, when you write a blog or something, you get these really nasty comments. A lot of commenters were saying things like, oh, we know you scientists like to play around with your little experiments in the lab and discover how things work. But, you know, we're in a recession now. We need to, you know, people are hungry and, you know, there's a lot of trouble and everybody needs money. Why should we give you money to do your little fun experiments? So some people still think, I think, that science is just dabbling and sort of playing around. And they don't really think, you know, everything that I'm doing, including the internet and the computer that I'm typing on to make these nasty comments, is actually because of science. And, you know, if you want to say science is important, then step away from that keyboard, you know. You know, you have no right to enjoy the fruits of technology and science and then just claim that it's not important for your life, because it's incredibly important.
I think more and more people are becoming aware of that, but it is definitely a prevailing conception. And here in the United States as well, there are politicians who routinely make comments regarding science and getting rid of funding of science or cutting funding of science. And the examples that they use about science research seems to land in that area of, oh, it's just dabbling. What is I think Sarah Palin made some comment about, oh, fruit fly. They're doing fruit fly research.
What a fruit, Paris, France, yeah.
Yeah, what do fruit flies have to do with me or, you know, my medical health, you know? And just it's the gap in understanding that continues to be continues to be a problem. You've been working on this for, you know, with your own blog, within your blog, with your Lab Lit website, with your own novels even, trying to I guess, bridge the gap. What is it that triggered you to start working in this capacity as more than just a scientist doing science, but actually a scientist as part of culture?
I think I'm an avid reader. I've been reading all my life, and I love stories about all sorts of things. But it did strike me that I had never, it was very rare to see a story about a scientist, just a normal, not a science fiction thing, but just a normal novel about scientists. They're very rare. And the first one that I read was Cantor's Dilemma by Carl Gerasi. And this was when I was in graduate school. I was working in a lab for the first time. I was so excited. And somebody gave me this novel and said, read this. It's got explicit science in it. And we were passing this book around, you know, people had underlined the science scenes, like there were sex scenes. I felt like it was in high school.
That's hilarious.
It was really, I've never read anything like it. I don't know if you've read the book, but it's this really, really accurate depiction of life in the lab. I thought, oh, great, I'm going to read every book like this. And I went to the bookstore. There's nothing. Tumbleweed. Whoosh, I couldn't find anything. Okay, since then I found a few from that era, but there are and continue to be hardly any books written with scientists as central characters doing science as part of the plot. They're not like intensely, you know, today I'm sitting at my bench and I'm pipetting DNA into this tube. But, you know, stories that are set in a lab where, you know, you get a little bit of atmosphere and you learn a little bit about what it's like to be a scientist, but that's not, you know, there are other things. You know, scientists are human, so it could be a love story or a thriller or whatever, but there's science in it. There's very little of that around. There's maybe just over 100 books that I've been able to find. So I think what started this was just this idea that why the heck are scientists absent now from this sort of whole sphere of fiction entertainment? Why are, you know, why was, does your newspaper section have a sports section, has a business section, it's got a family section, it's got money, finances, science, the science section is very rare. Okay, the New York Times has one, but pretty much every other section, every other newspaper that I picked up doesn't even, you know, maybe they have nature and tech, but science is not there. Why is science invisible? Why are scientists invisible? There are millions of us. Why doesn't anyone know what we do? Or why doesn't anyone care what we do? So that was the reason why I started to campaign in this area, because I thought it was ludicrous that something so important to culture could be just so invisible on the map of popular culture. They were worshiping sports figures and celebrities, but you know why aren't we worshiping scientists? I don't want to be worshipped, but you know, it'd be nice to appear on, you know, a chat show or David Letterman. You know, you don't ever see scientists on David Letterman, do you? I can't remember ever seeing one.
Yeah, you made a blog post. Just I think your most recent blog post was about the lack of female role models in science, you know, and talking about who could, why don't we have, you know, we have a, there's a campaign here in the United States, I don't know if it's in the UK, that's Rock Stars of Science. That's a campaign that it's with an advertiser, and I believe it came out in a GQ magazine.
GQ, yeah, we saw that this came out today, or this came out on Twitter today. I didn't know anything about it.
Yeah, they had one, the first installment, I guess, of the campaign came out at the beginning of the year. It was several months ago, and it had several male rock stars of science, you know, prominent geneticists and microbiologists, coupled with rock stars, real rock stars. And now there's a new Rock Stars of Science that just this week, right, it made its debut. And I think they're trying.
Was it all men?
I haven't looked at it, but I think they've been trying to get more women into it, but that's been a problem. It's mostly men. It is mostly men. I don't know. What do you think about that?
Well, the whole rock star thing's difficult, isn't it? I mean, if they're looking for scientists that are sort of like that, it seems like you're trying to force a trendiness onto something that you don't need to do. I mean, scientists are very interesting and quirky people, and do you really need to? Okay, I haven't seen the feature, so I shouldn't discuss it, but a lot of scientists here are criticizing it because it seems to be sort of, well, you know, Wired just shows scientists being themselves and they look really cool. Why does GQ have to force them into this sort of renegade rock star image? I don't know. I can't see a woman even feeling comfortable doing that. It just seems so embarrassing. I don't know. There just aren't enough female pundits. Don't get me started. I don't know why. I can't work it out. I really can't, because a lot of pundits are not, you know, sort of eminent professors. They're young people. Often they've dropped out of science. You know, they're sort of, at least in the UK, there's lots of sort of people who are on television. They're no longer practicing scientists. And, you know, we know that at least in biology, men and women are pretty much equal all the way through postdoc level, and then it starts to sort of divide. But at that sort of my age, it's 50-50. So why are all the young male, why all the young pundits male? There's plenty of women to choose from. I don't know if it's they're too shy or they're doing all the housework because their husbands are too lazy to help. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, I haven't quite been able to figure it out either. I think you know, here in the United States, we haven't really had any recent female scientists.
Yeah, I can't think of any.
Yeah, Every time I try and think about it, I'm like, yeah,
there's got to be somebody.
There's something missing here. And every time a new show comes out, it does on television or in the cable networks, it does seem to be hosted by men. There is there's a new science program for kids that's going to be hosted or is hosted by Carrie Byron, who is in Mythbusters. She's an artist, not a scientist, however. So,
and it's for kids. So
it's for
it's
kids,
okay for
not
a woman
for adults.
To be there.
You know, not to put it down or knock it in any way. I'm sure it's going to be a great, entertaining science program. However, the I guess the stereotype in Hollywood, you know, in the entertainment industry, has been set that you need to have a dynamic male figure to host these shows. I don't know necessarily about pundits, though, and why there are not more female scientists stepping up to actually sit next to politicians or, you know, other scientists on analytical debates about current issues within the news or other industries. I haven't seen that as much either. It's usually still more men.
There's some interesting psychological studies that have been recently collated together by a woman called Virginia Valian, who wrote a book called Why So Slow, which is about more generally why women in science are not, you know, they're not making it at the top level. And the basic premise is psychologically, science, when you think of a scientist or you think of science in your head, it's a male concept, basically. So if I ask you, you know, to think of a scientist, you'll probably picture a man, even if you're a woman, even if you're a female scientist. I know I do it. Also, you know, people say, you know, I went to see my doctor, and I say, oh, what did he say? I mean, you have this sort of inbuilt sort of default for things like science and medicine, that it's a male thing. And I think that we're always struggling to get beyond that and just to, does this make any sense? I think it's a great argument, and there's loads of studies that show, you know, if you make a bogus CV, a scientific CV, and you put a man's name on top and a woman's name on top, you know, people will read it and they will say, oh, they will rate the man as being more qualified, even
though
it's an
identical
CV.
They'd be more likely to hire the man.
and actually women as well. Women are even harsher on females than men are, according to these studies that Valian has collated together.
Yeah, that's interesting.
We can't help it. We're sort of hardwired to think of science and scientists and maths and all these sort of male things as being male. And probably, you know, when you're thinking, who do I want to have in front of that camera to represent science? Probably the first thing you think of is a man, because that's sort of manly. You know, it's manly. Science is manly. We need a man. You know, you're not really thinking that, but you can't sort of escape. And the only way to escape, according to this research, is you have to physically say, okay, I'm going to think about women now. Okay, now let's think about science. And then suddenly all these things flood in. You know, you think, oh, I know her. She's really smart. I met her at a meeting. Mm-hmm. She could talk about this. She could talk about that. You just have to get all the men out of your mind. And then you're allowed to sort of remember everyone. And it's something that you have to do when you're sitting on a committee and you're deciding, you know, who should we have to come speak at our departmental seminar every week. You know, if you don't watch yourself, you just name a bunch of men. I mean, it happens all the time.
Yeah.
And I think we all just need to be aware of that, especially women, and get beyond it.
Right.
And that's probably a problem, both in the profession as well as sort of in the media.
Yeah. And it may not be anything that, you know, it may be something we don't really understand psychologically why it happens, whether or not it is something that is, that we develop very, very early on in our developmental stages, or if it's something that's through schooling, it's just what we come to learn to do. We don't know that yet. We haven't teased it apart enough. So if we just understand that we do it, acknowledge that, and then say, okay, Let's now try and do things that will get away from that bias. Try and make it a more even playing field by acknowledging we have the bias in the first place. And that's probably, I think that's the best, that's one of the first places to start, because before you acknowledge that you have a bias, before you acknowledge you have a problem, there is no problem.
Yeah, the first step is admitting it. And also then what happens is you start getting women on TV, you start getting women being quoted in newspapers, and then it becomes more common. So then people see it more and it becomes more natural. And I think it's sort of, once you kickstart that cycle, I think you can then get more women in the public eye, because suddenly, oh, they're in the public eye. So, you know, oh, it's okay to have a woman in the public eye. And I think having 5 or 6 or 7 there, you know, really great women, will just attract more and more, because producers and editors will realize, wow, you know, there's lots of interesting women out there, and, you know, they have just as much to say as these same old men that we trot out time and time again, you know. Let's get some new faces in there, some new blood, so just new interesting perspectives. I mean, I don't think men and women do science differently. I know some people think that. I don't really agree. I mean, I do science like a man. You know, I'm very I'm competitive. I'm ambitious. You know, I raise my hand at seminars and ask questions.
But I think that happens for women in science who actually move forward in science, get to the postdoc stage, get into the applying for jobs, getting into an assistant associate professor. If you're going to move forward in the career scale in academia, you have to. You learn to act that way. You learn that you, number one, need to be competitive, like you said. You need to think in a way that is going to bring your research to the front. It's going to get it noticed. And how do you do that? You know, how are you going to, you know, get the job committee to pick you over somebody else? If you're in a seminar, you know, you have to meet people. You have to ask questions. You have to make yourself obvious. And that's, you know, the more you do that, I mean, this isn't just for science, but I mean, the more you do that, the more you're going to be noticed, the more likely it is that your name will come up when people start thinking of, oh, who do I know who could fit this role?
Yeah. But I don't think that's masculine. You know, for me, it's just normal. I think it's just confidence. And I was raised, my parents were great. They taught me that I was smart, and the things that I had to say were worth listening to. And, you know, I had a really good schooling, despite the fact that it was in Ohio. I just have always felt very confident about myself. And I think that's just my upbringing. I don't think it's a masculine way of doing things. I think it's just really a normal human way of doing things. And I think a lot of women don't act like that. And that's not normal. I think they've been sort of oppressed, or they've got low self-esteem, and probably because they've been forced to wear frilly pink outfits all their lives. No, not being allowed to run around in the mud. I don't know. I think we just have to get in touch with not our inner man, but just our inner confident person. I think that would solve a lot of problems.
Yeah. What is it that attracted you to science? How did you get into what you're doing, and what brought you to where you are?
I can't remember. I don't know if you can remember. I can't remember. I've always loved science. Yeah. I've always collected bugs and burnt things in my chemistry set. And I've always loved science, and I always wanted to be a scientist. So I can't really answer that question. I really have no idea. My family aren't scientists. I didn't have any role models at all that I can remember. I just love it. I always have.
Do you
remember?
Yeah, pretty much the same thing, just that I've always enjoyed it, and it was always the subject that I seemed to, you know, do really well at. It was kind of hands-on most of the time, and there was stuff to play with, and I could ask questions, and, you know.
Curiosity.
Yeah, my curiosity was allowed to roam in science classes, and so that's kind of the direction that I ended up going. Do you think that, or how has your confidence enabled your career? Have you run into, you know, some people in science, in academia, women, sometimes men, they say, you know, I had a PI that was really terrible, or I had this experience in grad school that really, you know, made moving forward in academia a very negative thing for me? Or have you had any experiences like that you've had to overcome?
Well, I actually left academia after my first postdoc. When I went to Amsterdam, I was working in a biotech company. Right. And I got laid off because the company went bankrupt. And it was absolutely traumatic. Although I was able to write novels on the Dutch government's dole for 9 months, I was absolutely traumatized. I'd never been without a career. I'd never been without an affiliation. You know, I'd never been without a job. And suddenly I had no job. I was stuck in this foreign country. I didn't know how to get back to science. And it's very difficult to get an interview when you're no longer in a lab. You know, you don't get asked anymore. It's very strange being unemployed. So I think working in the biotech and then not going bankrupt really derailed me, completely derailed me. I had to leave science for 4 years. I worked in the scientific publishing industry. And it was a bit demoralizing to be sitting next to 18-year-old kids earning the same salary that they were, you know, right, doing a menial editorial assistant job. I mean, I shot up the ranks pretty quickly because, I mean, if you've done a PhD and a postdoc, editorial is nothing. I mean, it's a very easy job if you have the sort of mindset. But I was, you know, and I remember I was sort of, you know, what am I doing? I was sitting in this office reading manuscripts and I want to be in the lab. And it was really, it took me a couple of years to bounce back from that. But eventually I got my act together and said, listen, I can get back to science. You know, I'm older now. I'm older. I'm not eligible for a lot of fellowships, but it turns out there's some great fellowships for women who've left science and want to come back, in Britain at least. They're called career reentry fellowships, and I was eligible, and I tried out for one, and I got it. So I was able to go back to the lab, and it did take a while then also for my confidence to return, because I couldn't remember anything.
Right,
I sit down to freeze and go, I need that enzyme, the one that starts with a K, that cuts DNA and makes blood ends. What the heck is that called? You know, my memory was completely shot. I spent every day in Wikipedia trying to remind myself, you know, how to do science. It all came back eventually. It was like a bicycle. It all came back. But there was a year there also when I was restarting my career that I was just completely, I couldn't remember anything. But I'm back now.
Now back better than ever.
I have been knocked down. But the trick is just don't give up. I really thought my career was over when I was stuck on the dole in Amsterdam. I really thought that this is it. But no. Damn it. No, I said, forget it. I'm not going to be cut down. I want to do science. I'm going to go back. So, yeah, sometimes you just have to sort of gather your courage and go for it.
Yeah, and I think that's a wonderful, you know, I guess, story for anybody to be able to follow whatever you want to do in science or beyond, outside of science. You have to trust yourself and that what you want to do. You know, don't, like you said, don't give up. If it's what you want to do, you might have to take that menial job editing with 18-year-olds, but you'll make it if you keep pushing forward and you don't allow your self-esteem to be diminished too much by the job that you're having to do at the time.
And the other thing I think that's really important to remember that I wish someone had told me when I was younger, I'm a postdoc in a lab and I'm older than my boss. I'm old enough to be the mother of some of the new postdocs, certainly the graduate students. So I watch them agonize, you know, like, oh God, I don't know, I'm not going to make it. I'm thinking, relax, honey, you've got 20 years at least. You don't have to decide something right away. The decisions you make now are not permanent. You can always try something and then come back, go forth. Things are very fluid. In this generation, we don't stay in the same job for life, perhaps. You know, we try other things. You know, you're 22 years old. Give yourself a break. You know, this is, you know, learn from me. You know, you can really go off and try other things, because a lot of my younger colleagues are worried about, you know, the career, and maybe it's not for them, but they're afraid to leave science because, you know, that's, you're not supposed to leave science. You know, it's you know, they think, oh God, I can't leave science. But you can. You can leave science. You can try something else. You can come back if you don't like it. But you're young, you know, you've got all the time in the world. Just trust yourself and experiment. If you want to experiment, try something else. I think it's important to remember that you can do whatever you want.
Yeah. Science isn't going anywhere. It's always going to be there for you. So you can try other things.
Yes.
As far as science and how people look at it in the UK, you've lived both in the United States and in Europe. Do you see any major differences? I mean, when I look, I see there are so many organizations in the UK that seem to have a real promotional, you know, outreach effort going on to make science understood by the public, or at least the aspect of science being an integral part of people's lives understood. And not so much here in the U.S. I mean, it's growing. It's definitely growing. But the U.K. seems like it has a head start on us. What are your impressions there?
It's definitely true. You know, you can live in London and within a year, if you're interested and you want to take part in this sort of public engagement activities, there's so much to choose from. And you can go from being, an unknown to being on the radio or being on TV or just sort of writing articles for the newspapers. People are really interested in, you know, you coming around to their schools and talking to school kids. You're right, it's really prevalent here. And there's lots of money to do it as well. It's very lucrative. There are lots of grants. So if you want to, you know, teach some kids something after school, you can get £5,000 to do it. It's lucrative. I don't know why that is, because I don't feel that science is as respected in the UK as it is in America. For example, nobody uses their title. In America, you're doctor. So here, people are embarrassed. They're sort of embarrassed to be scientists. And there's a lot of opinion polls where scientists don't rank too highly on sort of trust levels. But no, I don't know why this is, but I think that the public engagement that, especially in the last 10 years, that has really taken off here is going to make a difference. I mean, I've got to hope. And I think also in the curriculum, kids are learning not only basic science, but they're also being taught science and society issues. They're being taught about controversies like genetically modified food or vaccines and things. And they're making an effort to try to get not just science in there, but sort of how a good citizen needs to deal with science, even if they don't want to become a scientist themselves. So I think they're going in the right direction. And I've heard in the U.S. it's not so great. Certainly when I was in Seattle, I don't remember anything. Nobody asked me to do anything. I've never heard of any initiatives. I've never heard of any nothing. I mean, you were meant to stay in the lab for 80 hours a week.
Yeah.
Do your time. Yeah, maybe that's the difference here. People don't work 80 hours a week here. Sorry, boss. You know, people work maybe 40 or 50. It's very, very relaxed. We had lots of holiday. It's, you know, there's time to enjoy life. And I think in the U.S., the mindset is so turbo gunner. I don't think I could keep up the pace anymore. I really like it over here.
You're like, maybe I will stay here. Expats. Good call. Here in the U.S., it's definitely an interesting environment. I find that there is more and more, like I said, more and more of effort to try and get the citizen science movement going. As you said, the polls say that there's a lot of trust in scientists here in the United States. However, when it comes to certain controversial issues, that reverts to it disappears. The trust goes away, and people only trust certain scientists who profess the same, belief or give evidence that supports the belief that the person has. So
it's fascinating. It's not consistent at all.
It's absolutely inconsistent. Yeah. So I don't know if that happens similarly in the UK. I mean, You mentioned that there doesn't seem to be as much trust in general in the science profession.
I think British people just don't trust anyone. I mean, people rank very low in the polls. You know, journalists come in at 18% trust. The highest thing, I think the highest thing is priests or, you know, ministers and things.
No, that's the exact opposite. It's 81% trust here.
81. That's amazing.
Yeah.
But you're saying it's sort of a false trust. It's not, it doesn't go all the way through, which is a bit of a shame. I don't know. You know, I think the shadow of, you know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, I think these sorts of things can last a long time. People, you know, people still remember the atom bomb and all the scary things and the nuclear power, you know, nuclear scares. And I grew up with that. I think that is still, you know, people think, well, you know, they dropped that bomb. they can do things like destroy the world. And I think people have always mistrusted science because it is so powerful. And we do have to respect these fears because, you know, we probably could destroy the world. Not that we're going to, but you never know. You really never know. You could get an unscrupulous person who might do something. I mean, I don't sort of blame the public for being a little nervous when we're, you know, we're wielding all these secrets, and they are secrets. You know, they're sort of it's sort of a priesthood. You know, we have all this knowledge, and we're not very good at maybe explaining it very well. Yeah. They don't really know what we're doing. Maybe we are raising a clone army. You know, they have no way of knowing one way or the other because they don't go into labs. They don't see that we're just normal people listening to our iPods and, you know, trying to maybe cure a modest disease or two. You know, they don't. I might think, well, maybe they're trying to make weapons. Yeah, I don't know what people think, but I mean, you can blame someone for being a bit skeptical about these sort of scary secrets that they don't understand. I think it's perfectly valid to fear the unknown. I guess the key is to make it less unknown, sort of make sure that we explain what we're doing, and people realize that we do have good hearts and we are trying to help people and we're not doing terrible secret experiments without permission. I don't know how to engender that trust. I have no idea. But it does need to be done.
It absolutely needs to be done. I think the communication, so that like the ministry of science, you know, the cloistering of the knowledge doesn't occur, so that knowledge is disseminated to anyone who wants it. Information on what research is being done and why is available, so that if people want to look into it, they can. That kind of availability goes a long way toward increasing the trust. Just thinking additionally with communication, that scientists, I'm totally losing my thought here, that scientists need to not, that, like we went into earlier, there's the getting in front of the public to speak to them, to show that, we are just normal people. Everyone here is just normal. But the public has a role in this also, and that the public should be interested in what scientists are doing and not allow scientists to have too many secrets. You know,
there should
be, both sides of this should be an open conversation.
But they have to put in work too. You know, they just can't passively expect to imbibe really complicated information. I think people have to take responsibility for, okay, if they're not being educated properly in science, they, you know, parents have to, you know, say, listen, my kids need to know more about science. The world is becoming more and more science and technology intensive, and I don't feel my little Johnny or my little Mary is actually getting enough grounding. So maybe, you know, we need to improve education so it's a bit more up to snuff with current sort of the keeping pace with the sort of rapid changes in technology. You can't just say, okay, scientists have to go out and talk. You know, it's a two-way thing. People have to be willing to learn. They have to put in the time maybe to learn a bit more about these topics. They just can't sit there and soak it in. Biosmosis is not going to work that way. It has to be a dialogue, I think.
Yep.
Inspiring people who don't care about science is very difficult. You know, I get a lot of that. You know, when I tried to publish my novels, I'd get editors saying, oh, I've been avoiding science classes all my life and I didn't take any science in university and I don't like science, so I don't want to publish your book. You know, it's a great book. It's really entertaining, but no one's going to want to read it because it's about science. So we've got this attitude that science is this thing that you avoid. And we really have to change that culture because that prevents people from taking science classes in university. Maybe even if they're non-majors, maybe they're avoiding the science because they just think they don't like it. Why do they think they don't like it? Because the culture is that science is evil and scary, or it's scary, it's hard, it's difficult, you know, oh, it's a boy's subject, or it's boring, it's not, you know what I mean? There's all these sort of negative stereotypes about science, and I think that's got to be overcome. Because if people aren't interested, they're not going to listen to us, at the bottom line. And if they're not educated, they're not going to understand what we're saying, no matter how much we simplify it.
Yep. Well, we're about at the end of the hour. I really appreciate your talking with me today, making the time in your sleep schedule to join me.
I'm wide awake now.
Yeah.
I've been going all night.
Yeah, keep going. We've had some caffeine. No. Excellent. And anyone who is interested in seeing more, learning more about Dr. Ron, and I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly.
You're not, actually.
I'm
it's
not.
Roan.
Roan. Okay. Thank you very much. She has a website, jennyroan.com, and you can check out her books there. X Heart and Honest Look are both up on her website. There are links as well to LabLit, which is the webzine dedicated to laboratory culture and portrayal and perceptions of that culture. in fiction, media, and across popular culture. And I believe also should be a link to your blog somewhere in there. Here we go. Mind the Gap is the blog where you can... That didn't go where it was supposed to.
That's not good.
That didn't go where it was supposed to. The Mind the Gap blog, where you can read her thoughts on science, on politics, on life in the lab, bloggy type things. So once again, jennyrohn.com if you're interested. And that's about it for Dr. Kiki Science Hour for this week. Next time, it's Thanksgiving, and I am going to be taking a break. So next Thursday, I'm taking a day off next Thursday. So Thanksgiving, there will be no live show, I am sorry to say. And I do not believe we have a show scheduled for next Thursday. But coming up the week after that, we're going to be speaking about astrocytes, the cells that support our brains. They may be more of the brain stuff than the neurons themselves. You don't even know. We have to talk about all this stuff. There's exciting science in astrocytes. You don't even know. That's going to be in 2 weeks on Dr. Kiki's Science Hour. If you have missed episodes, if you want to subscribe, if you're interested in listening to those past episodes, you can go to twit.tv/Kiki, K-I-K-I. Additionally, you can find me here on the Twit Network with This Week in Science and Green Tech Today, both shows of a different substance. Science Hour is an hour of science. This Week in Science is a discussion of the week in science. And Green Tech Today is a show about green tech where we're focusing on our choices for top tech innovators around the world. And I think that's about it. Thank you once again for joining me. I do appreciate...
You're welcome.
Yeah, I do appreciate, Dr. Rohn, the fact that you've stayed up late and that you have, and the effort that you went through, you know, whether it was the steeped in America culture that got you to the point of breaking in England and starting a movement for scientists. You are definitely making a difference in many different areas, the laboratory, in writing, and also in social and political circles. So thank you very much. I do appreciate it.
You're very welcome.
And everybody out there, thanks for watching. I hope this hour made your world a whole lot more interesting.